Night, this is the Cutting Edge and I refer to there with you and next Wednesday sitting in with us for a little while is Sanjay. Let me see a picture of them on the Instagram there. You look good, trust me, you look good on Instagram, but most of them look good on Instagram still. What's your name? Keshima must about 150 posted picture on it in all different size, shape and form. I don't know where she gets so much picture from, but nobody now look on them. 28 views and all them things there. 10 views, 40 days, 10 views. Something wrong with the man. Shamara too. Shamara have some nice looking picture, but nobody now look on them either. Cox, they make me buck them up. Wanna look good still. This is the Cutting Edge and I refer me there with you. First order of business, you know, our Aboriginal name, Mikey Bennett. Mikey Bennett, as you know, is a long time producer and he used to do with Home T4 and all these things. He have a studio down at Grafton Road there where I do good things, wonderful things. As a matter of fact, I go down and go record already. More than one, more than two, more than three times. But you know, someone's take it upon themselves really pass on the baton to other ones, especially young people, and Mikey Bennett is one such youth brethren who pass on the baton and who is passing on the batons to other ones. So him have a project going on. We want to really facilitate the information station. We want to facilitate him, make him talk about this project, this new project. I think is a new project that is going on with him. Yeah, Mikey.
No, sir.
The oil man.
Give thanks. Well, I'm a good man. I'm good. Yeah.
Good. All right. No, before
thanks for the introduction and everything. Yeah, man.
Yeah, before we start talking about that, Feluki, we could talk about Feluki. Oh, man.
Yeah, we just got a, we have a chat group and we're just in the chat with him. He's in Mexico, as you know.
Oh, he's in Mexico. Oh.
Yeah, I'm in Mexico. I'm back to Mexico. We got X amount of funds. Never enough, but he did an operation and the doctors figured them got it was they were quite happy with what taking place.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a sprint, it's a marathon. So
yeah.
He might have to do some radiation thing. Mm. But he just got a CT scan today. So by tomorrow we'll have all of the details and a kind of outline of the treatment for, you know, going forward. I just got off the thing with him. So that is him thing. Spirits up and, you know, kind of keep us up to even sometimes we feel down.
Yeah.
But it's one of them things. Eh? And it's, I mean, as you saw, it was a wonder when the people got together to help them with one. Because all the way, like I tell people all the way, every time there is a situation, we as musicians are called upon to lend support and things.
Yeah.
And so we're really happy for how the public turned out to support one of ours. And I mean, we did. And, you know, sometimes during the game, you kind of feel frustrated and feel that, boy, the help not coming fast now. But you get a call the next day and someone says, listen, I didn't mean to do this and I never get a chance. So here it is. And you spread up again.
Yeah.
So we've been kind of just living off that energy. And we have to just keep, I mean, like, you know, it's Jawil and Gary that we have to just be prepared to accept that situation.
Yes. So, yeah.
But
yeah.
At the same time.
Yes. Yeah. Actually, I said that. There is money owed, or him need some more money if he can't.
Need more money, man. I'm going to need more money. Because you see, me envy the kind of faith that he have. Because those couple of us roll up and say, boy, now I got half, guys. The money looks tall.
Mm.
But he did the operation. And like I said, based on the CT scan that we're supposed to get tomorrow, we'll know the extent to which
him need money
for further treatment, and you know, in Jamaica and wherever, treatment need money.
Money is for ongoing, not for no way, my dear, so no, but for ongoing.
No, he did the thing, but you see, but because, as you know, well, I don't think most of us don't know, but when there is a operation, like a cancer operation, surgery, one of the surgeons have like two or three choices. What happened after? Because them say some things the knife don't get. And usually what them recommend is like a low dose of chemo to kind of pick up everything that them know, that the knife surgeon wasn't able to pick up.
Mm.
Whether it's chemo or whether it's radiation or whether it's just vitamin treatment. That will be determined based on what the CT scan
tomorrow.
Because these scans becoming more and more miraculous in terms of what they're able to show from time to time.
It's
just a pity that the medication not as miraculous in a lot of cases. But like I say, and he said it too, is that if him is a guinea pig for through a lot of things, alternative, then so be it. But we learn. I've learned so much about this thing. Yeah. Although my mom passed from cancer, but
yeah.
It shouldn't be a death sentence in 2017. And like I say, money shouldn't make nobody dead.
Yeah.
Or lack of money. That's our reality.
All we can do is just say.
Yeah, man. All we can do is open sometime. Like I said to my friend, it's like shoes that you plan for buying an extra sneaker. You have space in your closet for food. Send the money, come give me. It's simple.
Yeah, man. Give thanks, man.
Yeah, man.
All right, now. This you take. Conjunction with UTEC thing. Tell the people them what exactly.
All right. Well, there's this program that we have at UTEC. It is a part of Professor Hamilton's brainchild called It's a Free with Jamaica project. I was asked last year if I could pump it a program that could two or three things. The most important was increase it. The technical competence, in other words, improve on it. Because one of the things we know, Muta, in a lot of situations, a lot of things that take place in the country that we consider very negative are because youngsters don't have no hope, don't have no skill, don't have a lot of alternatives. So crime is right around the corner. So whether it's scamming, I don't think it leads to violence, or whether it's the human trafficking, or just intolerance, a lot of it be centered around people who don't have no job, don't have no skill. We have an industry, we have a legacy, as you know, in the music business, and everybody wants to be a musician. However, we have never approached it like how track and field approach things. Track and field, to me, in Jamaica, have the greatest template for unearthing talent, for mentoring talent, for coaching and things. And what it use is coaching. What takes place at Boys and Girls Champs is a culmination of all the little sports days and all of the coaches and all of the things that have gone through. When you think that the greatest, athlete the world has ever seen right now, there was a point in them career when people figure, said, boy, I'm done and I'm peak. And a man got to him and said, boss, allow me to mentor you and coach you for the next 2 years and do exactly what I say. And I can make it the greatest sprinter in history. And the rest is history right now. Ben Mills came with a scientific approach to coaching, mentoring the whole thing. And that has filtered down in Jamaica through the whole track. It was a product of a number of things.
Yeah.
Schools bought into it, parents bought into it, communities bought into it. And so everybody said, listen, here is something. If you have the ability to run, go to coaching. And we want to apply the same thing to the music. Because like I was telling somebody yesterday, as popular as the Olympics is, or the track and field is, Olympics is every 4 years, World Championship is every 2 years.
Music
every week, musicians leave Jamaica to go to foreign to earn.
Of course.
And as me and you know, Muta, we do have a problem. What it is that we cannot fill the request that we want out there for very talented people. We don't. We just not turning them out as fast as we think. There's this misconception in Jamaica that every corner you can find an next great singer. No, near in the business, I know how hard it is. Ask the young producers who have the device and the same set of talent. Ask Sunsplash and Sunset who have to be putting the same set of people on year after year. I believe, however, that in every little in Jamaica, there's another Jimmy Cliff, there's another Peter Tosh, there's another Muta Baruka with its crime talent that does need to be found, put through a program, encouraged to be them best. And we have a curriculum that says, listen, here is what we can do. We need to be able to say to high school or prep school teachers, listen, if you see a young person in your team that have a particular talent, just like how you spot them for champs and things. in the art.
Yeah.
Who can perform, who can sing, who can write, kind of move them in our direction. So there's a career path leading, so parents can get excited about this person who does singing every day. Yeah.
So when you say move them in your direction, you have a place, like a building where this a function from?
All right, let me tell you the physics. Okay, so the program is called the Masters in Residence Program. It's funded by the USAID. And it is part of the Fury Jamaica program project, right? So we have a budget to do certain things. So we have a performance coach, we have a voice coach, I'm the songwriting coach, and we have the management. We're offering 3-4 cohorts: management, songwriting, performing. Right now,
yeah.
So it is housed at UTEC, you know. So in terms of where it is, I'm employed to UTEC as a part time.
Okay.
To deal with this particular program.
Mm-hmm.
However, the program, is not confined to, as you know, in the DNA, we have both virtual and physical.
Yeah, movable.
Yeah, so, you know, we lose a lot of student time, we lose a lot of, there's a lot of workshops that take place. So the coaching and the mentorship is done in various facets. We have at least twice a week, we're at UTEC, on the UTEC campus, to have classes, for workshops, and for seminars. And, there's a management staff that manages the program, like any other effective program that takes care of, you know, the attendance and this and all of the disbursements that need to take place and the procurement that needs to take place.
Right, so let me ask you something.
Yeah,
it's something where you have to be recommended to, or somebody can just walk in and say, they would have liked this happen.
Well, what you'd like is, what you'd want to do, to apply, and which is why we're on the program tonight. We're looking for talent, the best talent that we can find. So if you think you are a singer, you go to the Fluid Jamaica Facebook page and you apply for the performance thing. You will be invited to an audition.
Okay.
If you're applying for the songwriting thing, you go and you follow instructions, you'll be asked to send in something that you've written.
Mm.
Or if something that you've recorded or something that, if you get a recommendation from Muta, say, listen, this poet is the best thing I've heard forever.
Yeah.
It's definitely okay. Here's someone that we need to see. For the management thing, it's pretty much it can become to based on your qualification and what we think you're looking for.
All right. But, wait, hold on, don't go so fast. We're going to write down the website where you say the ones them can link for.
Yeah, man.
Wait, hold on. Ready? All right. Tell me again.
Is it Fiwi Jamaica Facebook page? Fiwi JA.
Fiwi
JA. You see, you know.
Yeah.
Then you go on to the, when you go on there, you see the
Fiwi,
icon.
Fiwi, F-I-W-I. No, F-I-W-I.
F-I, yeah, Fiwi. Fiwi.
Yeah.
Fiwi JA.
Yeah.
So you apply, and then it gives you an option to apply for the area that you want to get trained in.
All right. You're talking about now instrumentation, voice training. All right. Where are we?
No, we're not doing instrumentation. We're doing voice coaching.
Okay,
in other words, no. But if you, so we have 3 cohorts: performing, performers, songwriting, management.
Okay.
So if you get accepted to the performance training, you will be assigned a vocal coach as well as a performance coach.
All right. So this is free, or you have to pay?
It is free. It is funded by the USAID. Yeah, it is free.
I see your thing. I don't know about that program when you say free.
Tomorrow,
man.
Well, let me tell you, there are good thing about it, though. It is also on the Western campus in Montego Bay. So we're going to be doing, we try to do a thing, but they must having some problems, so we figure we never get to see the kind of talent.
So who you contact down at the place then? Who you contact when you go there? Who you contact?
When you go on, no, let me, we
oh,
want
you have
online,
to leave online first. Okay.
The online thing makes things easy to work out. People can call me, and calling, and I send them straight to the Facebook page, because we have some information that we want. And in this day and age, to track people, we send out emails, we send out texts, WhatsApp, because we say, listen, here is it. Also, we have to think about that we want that paper trail or electronic trail.
Yeah, you know, okay. I know 100 people go down at the school and have to stand up there. And
no, we don't need that. Yeah, I mean, we took on the work for the 200 applications and see which one. And everybody who applies for the thing will be auditioned. We can guarantee that. And it's auditioned by at least 3 professionals in the business.
All right. So
it's not a joke thing.
All right. If you get accepted, now, in what length period of time each
person... Well, the program is a 6-month comprehensive program. It's a comprehensive, real, like your work.
How much time a week?
At least twice a week. But you know, like I said, because you're dealing with individual coaches, so you guys arrange the performer and his performance coach and his voice coach are going to have one-on-one sessions as well as the group sessions. So we have compulsory programs that you need. And on a Tuesday evening, we have seminars, we have workshops, and we have a lot of group sessions. So we need to do it.
Okay.
What I should also say, one of the things that bring the program together is a musical. So we just wrote a musical, and we have 20 original songs for musical from
Tagwan.
This is the second year, you know.
Oh, it's the second year, Tagwan.
It's the second year. You so we kind of have the template down to a science, you know.
So what makes you hide it, man?
Yeah, it's my bad. But we'll make sure so we get it right for Jamaica first, you know.
Yeah.
So this one now, the next one now, so the people coming in will get to audition for a musical. And we just realize how important a musical is, because you get to look at the performance training and the songwriting fit, and then the management people will have to manage the whole process and try and make some money, monetizing the whole musical when it finish.
Yeah.
So that is, so it fits very well into the whole program.
Yeah.
But I want to tell young people that, listen, I'm a very hard taskmaster, as so are the other people. Because, like I say, this is not a joke time. This is not a weekend. This is not a vacation.
This
is serious work. Serious work.
Yes.
We're spending money. The program buying studio time. So when I'm going, it's not a joke.
Joke business.
And we have the very best, I think, very best professionals.
You want to name somebody?
Communication coach.
You want to name somebody professional?
It's the kind of thing I wish we won't see that when we were trying to do at the red side.
Yeah. No, I mean, if you want to name some of the professionals who are involved with it, like yourself.
Well, I'm the songwriting coach. We have Philip Clark, who works at UTEC, who runs the Center for the Arts. Michael Holgate,
the musical Garvey, the Garvey man.
Yeah, man. Okay. Yeah. And the other Michael Harris, as vocal coach.
Okay.
So you see, we have all of the mics that we need right now. So we can make a chance.
Michael.
Yeah, well, 3 mics. 3 tenors. Well, not tenors, but 3 mics.
Yeah.
No, but we have Fabian, who is a communications guru, he does a lot of the communications training. You'll be surprised how much people don't have a, what we call an elevator pitch, can't sell themselves effectively, can't represent what they're doing. So these are the things that you do. You write your bio, be able to do an effective interview, how to sing, how to present yourself, how, and let me tell you, Mota, it's the hardest I've worked in probably 15 years. But I tell you, I've never imagined, but is the most fulfilled I've felt for a long time. When you see a young person who go up on stage and shy and doing everything wrong in terms of representing himself, and after 2 sessions, you see that same person go back and think. And let me tell you, we tape you when you come in.
Yeah.
Videotape you.
Yeah.
Videotape you throughout the process. And at the end of it,
the
coach have a chance to go back and look on
developments.
Exactly. So, in other words, I can't speak without any kind of hesitation that we have a program now that works.
All right, I can ask you a question now. Since last year, you can name anybody who would have said passed through the course and is now part of the music industry, the music fraternity.
Well, let me tell you, it's kind of, I am making some predictions now. There are some people who, you probably know, Indy. There's Jamila plays the double bass and things.
Yeah.
And she has a song now, which I have no doubt is going to be one of the female anthems in Jamaica for the next thing. We have a Tamoji, we have a Jazai, and we have a Minori. These are, we have at least six people who right now can hang a hat and say, listen, we have been sending them. I mean, requests have been coming in. Wherever they have performed, people have called to request that we get them to come back, come to something. And they have been performed. I've actually used them on five commercials so far to rear reviews.
Yeah.
So both as writers and as performers, we have used them. And so them graduate from the first set of program now. So, and you know, we kind of, I'm always here to support them. So every opportunity I get, I say, and you know, we get these calls from time to time. You know, somebody, just this evening, I got a call from a place wanting a Christmas program. And I said, yes.
By the way, Jackie loved the band, ready up to the other night, you know. Up at Red Bones, Maxine Walters.
Yeah, and that is a young, but you see what can happen when young people. Mm. But that is my cousin's band.
Which school them come from?
JC.
No, them sweet, I mean, man. Well, hear my lady, I suggest now. I have a little singer here, you know, named Zyla Ford.
Mm-hmm.
She said, I should I connect them and say, because she, Zyla Ford, has been on the music scene as a little 13-year-old, when she had 12 still, 12-year-old. And she envisioned, said she could have a link with them, so who should we talk to? You?
You mean link with the band? The band in it?
Yeah, the band, yeah.
You know Ruan, do I?
No, but if you tell me about Ruan, no, then I'll find him.
But just give her my number when you don't move. I can make the connection.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, always do that.
Because we are work with a little girl, just like how you say you work with. We are work with a little daughter here for about a year now. Mm. We carry a studio about. Yeah, we carry a studio. We have a new tune. We're going to play the tune when you don't have it, you can listen to her.
You mean listen, man?
And. My wife, I say, she envision that little girl that sing with a band there. And she really, my wife have a keen, she have a vibes when she come on to that still.
Good.
All right.
Like I said, that's an easy hookup. Right?
It's
your family that.
All right. So, yeah, so now, tell me the days them when.
Well, hear what I want to say now, because sometimes you don't know, sometimes some youngsters not listening. I am appealing to parents, our uncles, our aunties, our people like yourself, who know some like a talent, who don't even realize how talented they are.
Yeah.
But I'm not looking for average talent. I try to find some good talent because we want to move it fast. We figure we can move a good talent to a great talent within a short period
of time. Of course.
So we industry need right now about 15 to 20 really good young singers. Singers, vocalists. DJs, singers, but at a particular level. We want some more Sanchez and some Brian Gould and some more.
We want all them.
At that level.
Yeah, man, definitely. Right? Yeah.
We understand now, and me, you know, that record not selling anymore.
No.
The two major source of income is songwriting
touring.
And performance.
And tour,
so we want these people out to perform. We want to make sure that when people see people, them call and tell them friends, listen, you have to go watch a person. You have to. The experience is such a powerful one that it lead and people want invest money.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you have to be financing all of your recordings, that means that you're not impressing enough people. And money out there, you know.
Yeah.
Money is out there looking for the right kind of investment. Indeed. And that is what we're doing. As I mentioned, that we have a legal person now, so there's a lot of legal training involved in the program. Mm. The whole, you know, apart from what the free thing that JK come, we have on staff, a lawyer,
we're
going to contract administration, from Drum Street, everything you need to do to protect yourself and to, you know, be user friendly then.
So comprehensive, man. It's not like a real.
No, trust me. If you're excited, it makes sense.
Yeah,
comprehensive, and you know, it's the kind of thing that I'm happy I got an opportunity to do. I mean, like I said, it's a whole for work, but
yes,
at night time it's my
rewarding.
Oh God, yeah, man. And one of these, what I'll do shortly, as soon as we get somebody the music mix for the thing.
Yes.
I'll call you and send you some, and you can, you know, you can.
You know, so we always did a
couple of people.
All right.
That's what really the next part of the thing is to kind of give them a little large and fine.
All right.
Using all of the contacts that we have.
All right, we have to move now. Give thanks.
Yeah, no, man, give thanks for the reason, man.
Yeah, man. And just keep right? Inform, do you know? Anytime you see me any function, just say, Muta, you want to see this and this happen. And,
I will. You know me, if you find
them. All right, sir. All right, give thanks. So, hang up the phone and listen to the little daughter me I tell you about.
I'm going
to
do that right now, man.
Yeah, all right, give thanks. Yes, that was, me I tell you, that Virginia Home T4, for those of you who know Home T4 from them time. Who are you look back at case, you know? My farmer, schoolmate from Kingston Technical High School, yes. Well, Mikey Bennett was part of that group, and he was also one of them big producers from Dunga Music Works. With them days there, yes, with Gussie Clark and them man there, big hits them in my ball over the place. So, in my spirit of movement, you know, to train songwriters, performers, and managers, very, very important in at this time, yeah. We need some serious trainer and trainees for work with the music, you know, because we are come out, you know, it now go work out now we're there. I mean, we can count from one finger the good music them and the professionalism in other music as it relates to the internationalization of reggae dancehall music. Yes, so we're there with you. So, yeah, this is the Culture Edge and IRFM, you know, say we're going to turn it over now to Pat Clark, Jamaica Roots and Culture.
Welcome to Jamaican Roots and Culture. I'm Pat Clark. Bunny Wailer is a living legend in Jamaica's music history. Born on April 10, 1947, as Neville O'Reilly Livingston, Bunny Wailer, also known as Jabi, is a Jamaican singer, songwriter, and percussionist. A three-time Grammy Award winner, he's considered one of the long-time standard bearers of reggae music. In 1963, Bunny Wailer formed the Wailing Wailers with Bob Marley and Peter Tosh. Junior Brathwaite and Beverly Kelso were also members of the band. Bunny Wailer tended to sing lead vocals less often than Marley and Tosh in the early years. But when Bob Marley left Jamaica in 1966 for Delaware, Bunny Wailer began to record and sing lead vocals on some of his own compositions, such as Who Feels It Knows It, I Stand Predominant, and Sunday Morning. His music is said to have been influenced by gospel and soul of Curtis Mayfield. In 1967, Bunny Wailer recorded This Train, based on a gospel standard, for the first time at Studio One. Bunny Wailer continued to sing with the Wailers when Bob Marley returned to the island from Delaware. He contributed to the distinctive harmonies that the group became famous for. Wailer sang lead on Dreamland, Riding High, Brainwashing, and on one verse of the Wailers' Keep On Moving, both produced by Lee Scratch Perry. In 1973, each of the three founding Wailers operated their own label. Marley with the Tuff Gong, Tosh with HIM Intel Diplo, and Bunny Wailer with Solomonic. Bunny Wailer sang lead vocals on Reincarnated Souls, the B-side of the Wailers' first island single of the new era, and on two tracks on the Wailers' last trio LP, Burning, Pass It On, and Hallelujah Time. By then, Bunny Wailer was recording singles in his own right, cutting Searching for Love, Lifeline, and Buy It Up. Bunny Wailer toured with the Wailers in England and the United States, but soon became reluctant to leave Jamaica. He and Tosh became more marginalized in the group as the Wailers became an international success and attention was increasingly focused on Bob Marley. Bunny subsequently left the Wailers in 1973 to pursue a solo career after refusing to tour when Chris Blackwell wanted the Wailers to go on tour in the United States. Before leaving the Wailers, Bunny became more focused on his spiritual faith. He identified with the Rastafari movement, as did the other Wailers. He has also written much of his own material, as well as re-recording a number of cuts from the Wailers' catalogue. Bunny Wailer has recorded primarily in the Roots style, in keeping with his often political and spiritual messages. He and Tosh would frequently sing each other's background vocals in the start of their solo careers. The album Blackheart Man is a good example of his Roots reggae style. After leaving the Wailers, Bunny Wailer experimented with other musical styles. However, he had a dancehall rocker's edge that was best exemplified by the album Bunny Wailers Sings the Wailers, in which he reinterprets some of the Wailers' material as a solo Roots singer, backed by a solid Sly and Robbie bass Roots reggae grouping. Bunny Wailer won the Grammy Award for Best Reggae Album in 1991 for the album Time Will Tell, a tribute to Bob Marley, 1995 for Crucial Roots Classics, and 1997 for Hall of Fame, a tribute to Bob Marley's 50th anniversary. He was also featured in the album True Love by Toots and the Maytals, which won the Grammy Award in 2004 for Best Reggae Album and showcased many notable musicians including Willie Nelson, Eric Clapton, Gwen Stefani of No Doubt, Ben Harper, Bonnie Raitt, The Roots, Ryan Adams, and Keith Richards. In August 2012, it was announced that Bunny Wailer would receive the Order of Jamaica, and in 2016, he played a month-long Blackheart Man's tour to celebrate the 40th anniversary of his 1976 album. On October 16, 2017, Bunny Wailer was awarded the Order of Merit by the Jamaican government. Jamaica continues to honor the living legend. And now to end Jamaican Roots and Culture, here's our famous quotation from the Black Diaspora. I have never been contained unless I made the prison. The words of Marie Evans. For Jamaican Roots and Culture, I'm Pat Clark.
Got the research. I love our researchings. Believe you me, our researching them is really something else. Okay, what were they? Were they at this? Here we go. Big music. You know, last week, where did I go? Play a tape and we never get to play it because of the whole heap of Montego Bay issues where they are going. Well, you know we're going to play it tonight, yeah. And it is really a documentary upon Port Royal. And after we've done that, we are going to go to after 12. You know, say after 12, ushering the 2nd of November, which is the coronation celebration of Emperor Haile Selassie I, King of Kings, Conquering Lion of Judah, Elect of God, Light of the World. Those titles was not given to him by no Rasta. It is the official title of the Emperor, Rastafari, Haile Selassie I. So, we're going to celebrate musically after this, what we call documentary on Port Royal, and I think it's a very interesting documentary. If it's never interesting, won't tell you if you listen to it. So we want to bring you live. When we say live now, we are talking about the program on your radio. Live by your radio now. A documentary on Port Royal. Here goes.
To the casual eye, it may look like nothing more than a sleepy little fishing village, typical of those found throughout the Caribbean. But Port Royal is different. Beneath its waters lies a unique time capsule, a sunken city more than 300 years old.
Port Royal is the most important underwater archaeological site in the Western Hemisphere. There's more history and archaeology down there than 50 or 100 shipwrecks all combined.
The history of Port Royal's sunken city, its legendary rise, its catastrophic fall, and promising rebirth begins in the middle of the 17th century when European nations fought over possession of land in the New World.
It's hard to underestimate the importance of the Caribbean in that period. The Caribbean was the Wild West for Europe. It was the frontier. And the pirates and the privateers, the buccaneers, they were the vanguard of the expansionist countries and responsible for achieving nationalist aims and also for a lot of the immigration.
If the Caribbean was Europe's Wild West, then Port Royal was its Dodge City, a boom town full of pirates, prostitutes, and purveyors, and where silver and gold were as plentiful as rum. Its rapid growth began just after England seized Jamaica from Spain in 1655. The British Crown, seeking to prevent the island from being retaken, immediately built Fort Charles, the first of six defenses, and one of the few buildings that would withstand the Great Quake. The Crown also recruited a cutthroat class of seafaring souls to harass Spanish ships and settlements in the Caribbean. The response was overwhelming. They came from as close as the island of Tortuga, where the infamous Brethren of the Coast, or Buccaneers, were kicked out by the Spanish, and from as far away as France, Holland, and of course, England. Those who accepted official commissions were called privateers. Those who operated independently were pirates. Either way, these rough and ready men formed a fearless fleet and made Port Royal their base of operations.
Port Royal became a pirate haven, pirate heaven really, because it lay at the center of the Caribbean, and the English wanted to dominate the Spanish shipping lanes. Spain was wealthy but weak, and England and the other European powers wanted their share of the New World riches. And Jamaica was in a wonderful location, and Port Royal an even better one, on the south side of the island with a wonderful sweeping quay that formed a natural harbor that could easily hold 500 ships.
Nearly everyone, it seems, in Port Royal was a pirate at one time or another. Protecting the island in exchange for plunder was too good an offer to refuse.
Being a pirate was a very opportunistic way of making a living. People would do it off and on, and so it wasn't that you was a pirate exclusively. You might be working in a tavern in Port Royal, and then one of the merchants is fronting the money for an individual, and they're going to go off on a raiding at one of the coastal Spanish towns, and so you would go with them. But then when you came back, well, you know, you would just go back to your normal job. So it was an occupation that people crisscrossed back and forth at all the time.
Commodore Christopher Mings, a British naval officer and a privateer, brought in Port Royal's first great haul. More than 20 chests filled with silver coins and gems worth £500,000. His tactics earned him the nickname El Diablo, the devil, from the Spaniards. These hand grenades help explain why. Mings and his successors used them as part of their arsenal to terrorize Spanish vessels carrying trade goods from Europe and the Orient. The iron balls filled with gunpowder were lit with a fuse, then tossed onto the deck of a galleon. The explosion caused death and injury. When the smoke cleared, the Spaniards surrendered their silk and silver. The practice proved remarkably successful. There were no serious attempts by Spain to retake Jamaica, and everyone got rich. Within 7 years of Port Royal's establishment, so much gold and silver had poured into its coffers from piracy that there was more running cash there, proportionate to the population, than in London. A resident observed, "The town, being as it were the storehouse or treasury of the West Indies, is always like a continual mart or fair, where all sorts of choice merchandises are daily imported." As this salvaged Japanese sword suggests, the markets of Port Royal were a cornucopia of plunder and contraband, a place where anything, from Oriental objects of art to African slaves, could be had for a price.
Any of the material that was coming in through piracy into Port Royal within 2 or 3 days was now in the hands of the merchants. And so it's the mercantile industry of Port Royal that actually made it the wealthiest English town in the New World.
Port Royal was also the most populous English town in the New World. Bigger than Boston, it boasted a population of between 6,000 and 8,000 people. A brass menorah recovered from a sunken synagogue reflects their diversity. At a time when the British colonies of North America were largely single-faith enclaves, Port Royal supported Jewish, Quaker, Catholic, and Anglican houses of worship. The local clergy's faith, however, was sorely tested. One out of every four buildings in town was either a brothel or a tavern, prompting one reverend to condemn Port Royal as the most wicked and sinful place on earth. The pirates' decadent ways were indeed legendary. When they returned from their adventures, they were only too eager to blow their booty, indulging their every vice. According to an early history of Jamaica, wine and women drained them of their wealth to such a degree that in little time, some of them were reduced to beggary. Port Royal's most celebrated prostitute, Mary Carleton, was likened to a barber's chair. No sooner was one out than another was in. The governor of Port Royal commented that the Spaniards wondered much at the sickness of our people until they knew the strength of our drinks, but then wondered more that they were not all dead.
Port Royal, the wicked city, was noted for its drinking, debauchery, gambling, etc. And of course, these guys imbibed from morning to night. And a lot of guys made their own drinks, especially the rum, which was called Kill Devil's Rum. And a lot of times it was mixed with gunpowder. And in the house of a David Owens that we worked in, we found his still. This was used for making rum. Of course, it was heated under here. Stuff was distilled and put in onion bottles like you see here, so named because of the shape. And in this particular house, we found several hundred of these onion bottles. A lot of them were still sealed. We had used hypodermic needles and got an idea what the contents were. And these guys didn't mess around just with drinking with little small glasses or jiggers. They used big things like you see here. This is a German beer stein made of stoneware, or you could call it a tankard. It's actually a shape of a tankard. Some people call them flagons. And so you can imagine, it would take two of these bottles just to fill one of these. And when a guy was drunk or came back from a new sortie where he captured a whole bunch of treasure, they'd go down with barrels, running down the street with barrels, and insist everybody had to take a drink. And they filled this thing to the brim and said, chug-a-lug. And could you imagine drinking that much rum? You just pass out and fall on your bippy. So those were the great days to live. Too bad I couldn't have been there myself.
There was one man who personified Port Royal's raucous social scene. He was Henry Morgan, pirate extraordinaire. He didn't just raid ships. He invaded countries. His exploits, more than anyone else's, would give Port Royal its mythic aura. Of all the pirates who made their base in Port Royal, none was more famous than Henry Morgan. He had come to Jamaica from Wales as an indentured servant, but soon took up freebooting. His exploits on the high seas made him the most celebrated and feared pirate of the 17th century.
He's separated from other pirates because he was a brilliant tactician. He was courageous, many of them are, but in spite of the fact that he often had fallings out with the men of his company, he was incredibly successful.
Morgan's expeditions rivaled those of any nation's army of the period. His most ambitious raid took place in 1670, when his force of 2,000 buccaneers invaded Panama City, the main depository of Spanish gold and silver on Central America's Pacific coast.
They made an incredible trek through the jungle. They didn't take any stores with them. They counted on finding food. They didn't. They almost starved to death. The men were actually cutting up their shoes and boiling the shoe leather and their pieces of their leather pouches to eat.
When Morgan's force finally arrived in Panama City, a desperate battle ensued in which fleeing Spanish soldiers burned the city down and loaded its treasures onto departing ships. Once in control, Morgan's men tortured residents until they revealed where they had hidden their valuables. The booty piled up quickly. Silver plate, gold ingots, and 750,000 pieces of eight.
When they got back to the Caribbean coast, again at great cost to life, men dropping of disease and jungle fever, there was a falling out. After all that effort, there were only 200 pieces of eight per man. When Morgan sailed off ahead of some of the men, they felt that he had skimmed off the best for himself.
The men may have been referring to these pieces. Rarely put on public view, they are known as Morgan Silver, believed to be the only known plunder remaining from the raid on Panama City. Upon his return to Port Royal, Morgan was hailed as a conquering hero, but King Charles was not pleased. England was now at peace with Spain. The Spanish king threatened to declare war if those who destroyed Panama City went unpunished. In response, King Charles imprisoned the colonial governor who approved Morgan's venture. But a different fate awaited the popular pirate.
The British crown really needed to get rid of the pirates at this point because they were developing their own commercial viable colonies, and the pirates were becoming an embarrassment. And so what a better way to catch pirates than to set a pirate to do it?
The king knighted Morgan and appointed him lieutenant governor of Jamaica. By day, he sat in judgment of his fellow buccaneers. But at night, he secretly arranged for them to continue their trade for a price. But it was Sir Henry who ultimately paid it.
It must have been extremely difficult for Morgan to have been the buccaneer par excellence and then have to sit in judgment on petty pirates and buccaneers. And he sank into debauchery and drunkenness and was a kind of a shambling old mess at the end. But this is the story of piracy, and it's certainly the story of Port Royal, which was brash and bright for a while and then was extinguished.
Morgan died a bitter, broken alcoholic in 1688. A short poem mourned the passage of the man and his times. You was a flyer, Morgan. You was the lad to crowd when you was in your flagship. But now you're in your shroud. Morgan's era was over. But Port Royal continued to thrive into the early 1690s as a pirate haven.
Sometimes we're as many as 150 buccaneer pirate ships raid in here, and of all different nationalities. I mean, we're talking about people who were plundering in the Red Sea, plundering off of Madagascar, all around the world. They all came here.
But the boom could have gone bust at any moment, not from sudden political changes, but rather from geological shifts. Port Royal was precariously situated on a thin spit of land at the tip of the Palisados Peninsula.
It's unconsolidated sand with the water table of 1 foot to 2 feet beneath it. And so they build this town up on it, and you can't dig foundations for the houses because you hit the water table too quickly.
As a result, Port Royal has always been vulnerable to natural disasters. Just how much can be seen in this structure, the Giddy House. It tipped over in an earthquake in 1907 and got its name from the sense of disorientation it induces in those who enter. It's nothing, however, compared to what Port Royal experienced back in June 1692.
The denizens of Port Royal were no strangers to catastrophe. They were frequently beset by hurricanes. They'd had an earthquake 4 years earlier, a minor one. But the morning of June 7th was frightening to those few people who were up really early and saw that the sea was strangely glassy. As the morning wore on, it was terribly sultry. The air was very heavy. And the sky turned a brassy color. Shortly before noon, there was an absolutely apocalyptic event.
In many places, recounted a survivor, the earth cracked, opened, and shut with a motion quick and fast. And of these openings, 200 or 300 might be seen at a time. In some of these, people were swallowed up. In others, they were caught in the middle and pressed to death. And in others, the heads only appeared, in which condition the dogs came and ate them.
Here you have 2,000 buildings and all but about 160 slid into the sea in a matter of seconds because there were also three tidal waves, and almost all the shipping in the harbor got all freaked up and thrown on top of the buildings, and it's really scary. It's like some of these Hollywood movies, but this actually happened to these people.
Perhaps the most compelling account of the earthquake is etched on the headstone of Louis Galdi in the graveyard of St. Peter's Church. He was swallowed up in the great earthquake by another shock thrown into the sea and miraculously saved by swimming until a boat took him up. Galdi was one of the few to survive. He went on to become a church warden, The fate of his fellow citizens must have given him cause for prayer. 2,000 people, about a third of Port Royal's population, died immediately in the disaster. Approximately the same number perished in the following weeks from diseases caused by the rotting of unburied corpses. The town itself was devastated. 33 acres, nearly two-thirds of Port Royal, collapsed into the sea. Gone was everything from five of the island's six forts to Henry Morgan's grave. Even in its decimated state, Port Royal's notorious reputation survived. Looters roamed the streets, cutting off the fingers of the dead to more easily pilfer their rings. Others dove into the water, recovering what they could from the rubble below.
REFM, thought-provoking, always smoking, lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka. REFM, thought-provoking, always smoking, lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Muta Baruka.
Others dove into the water, recovering what they could from the rubble below. Clergymen preached this catastrophe of biblical proportions was God's punishment for Port Royal's wicked ways. Perhaps they were right. The town was never the same. Though rebuilt, it was hit by a series of hurricanes and fires that drove many residents to relocate to Kingston, a new settlement that became the island capital. Scientists, however, have another explanation for the cause of the disaster.
The key to the destruction at Port Royal is the fact that it's on this unconsolidated sand. And when you get unconsolidated sand like that and in a major earthquake, the violent shaking suspends every particle of sand with water momentarily. So what is firm foundation ground at one point now is just a liquid. It's just like water.
Whether by liquefaction or God's wrath, the earthquake turned Port Royal into an instant time capsule. Like Pompeii and Herculaneum, Roman cities buried by a volcano in 79 AD, Port Royal was now that rarest of archaeological phenomena, a catastrophic site.
The thing about Port Royal that makes it so special and unique is the fact it's the only sunken city in the New World. There's not another one like it because of its historical importance and the extremely good preservation present at the town. It's the dream of any nautical archaeologist to excavate.
Edwin Link was the first nautical archaeologist to make that dream come true. In 1959, under the auspices of the National Geographic Society and the Smithsonian Institution, he led an expedition to survey the sunken city. Link conducted his work about 100 yards offshore, near a buoy known as the Church Beacon. Legend holds that it marks the site where St. Paul's Church sank in the earthquake. Beneath the buoy, Link recovered a wealth of artifacts, none more intriguing than this pocket watch. An X-ray photograph of the face reveals traces of its vanished hands stopped at 11:43.
It's probably the first time in the history of archaeology that the actual time of the destruction is actually recorded with frozen hands on a watch dial.
Link's expedition literally put old Port Royal on the map and changed the minds of skeptics who believed that because of reconsolidation, a natural landfill process, there was little, if anything, left of the sunken city.
Link's greatest contribution was the fact that he proved that there was a sunken city down there and that it had great merit to have somebody have a bigger project.
That somebody was Bob Marks, an underwater archaeologist. He would lead his own expedition 5 years later and recover enough artifacts to rival the plunder of any Port Royal pirate. Edwin Link's 1959 expedition to Port Royal and his recovery of the pocket watch indicating the time of the earthquake intrigued many with the probability of more treasures to be found below. Perhaps no one was more curious than Bob Marks, an underwater archaeologist imbued with the lore of the sunken city.
When I was 5 years old, I read a book about a guy who claimed that he walked the streets of Port Royal. The cathedral bell was chiming. Skeletons were in the taverns with flagons in their hands drinking the booze. And I read that over and over and over, and I kept saying, one of these days, I'm going to go there and do that.
That day came in 1964 when a development company announced plans to turn Port Royal into a Caribbean version of Colonial Williamsburg. That meant dredging for cruise ship piers right where the sunken city was located. When Marks heard that news, he took action.
I was able to convince the governments, with the help of the Organization of American States and UNESCO, both organizations which I was consulted to in underwater archaeology, to save all the goodies down there. And little did I know at the time that I'd spend the next 4 years around the clock working and only do a tiny part of the site, like 5% of the overall site.
Marks excavated that portion of the site most threatened by the proposed dredging. Working in depths as low as 25 feet, he used an airlift, a long vacuum-like tube, to pump the silt onto a barge where small artifacts collected on a screen. Marks didn't know what he would find, but he had a dream.
From the very, very beginning, when I first started the excavation here at Port Royal in 1964, I dreamt about, let's find Henry Morgan's grave, because we knew he was buried at Port Royal, or at least his tombstone.
Marks's quest wasn't easy. Sewage from Kingston severely limited underwater visibility. Sharks lurked nearby. Cave-ins and earthquakes threatened.
You're working in a cesspool, but the information that you're getting, you can't get anyplace else. So we put up with it day in, day out. And every morning, you know, I'd wake up so excited, say, okay, what am I going to find today?
Apparently, a lot. Marks may not have found Morgan's grave, but he and his divers seem to have salvaged everything else. They recovered thus far the largest haul of artifacts from the sunken city, in the millions by Marks' own estimate, all of which fit his definition of treasure.
Treasure is anything of importance to mankind that comes out of the sea or from a land site. So treasure doesn't have to be gold and silver. It's something that's interesting for people, and it's something that adds to the knowledge of the past. That's what treasure is.
Some of Marx's most interesting treasures are the oldest ever found in Jamaica.
Soon after I started the excavation, I realized that others had lived there before the pirates settled in Port Royal in 1655, because I began finding Arawak artifacts. Arawaks were the first settlers on the island. They were there at least 1000 AD, and they were all over the Caribbean in different islands. And some of the first artifacts we found were these religious figurines that you see here, made out of stone, probably of Indian gods. And we found several of those also in wood, in very good condition. And the next thing we started to find was a number of ceramic vases and pots like you see here. This particular one here is really great because it's in the shape of an Arawak canoe that was used mainly for fishing and transportation between the islands. And these adzes or axe heads are interesting because these two here are made out of jadeite, and the nearest source of jadeite is Guatemala, which shows that they had trade, you know, all the way to Central America. The two biggest are weapons used to fight, and the smaller one is used as kind of a axe for chopping wood or digging out a canoe or something like that. So it really was great to find all these Indian artifacts on the site.
Most of Marx's finds are fittingly stored in a landmark building, Port Royal's Old Naval Hospital, built in 1819 and owned by the Jamaica National Heritage Trust. As the main repository for Marx's artifacts, the hospital has become a latter-day version of the city that sank just beyond its seawall. The grounds are littered with artillery Marx brought up from various shipwrecks, including mortar balls from what is believed to be the Ranger, a vessel that once belonged to pirate Black Bart Roberts, and cannon from what may be the HMS Swan, a British naval vessel that was thrown onto a building by one of the three tidal waves that followed the 1692 earthquake. Even the outhouses claim a connection to Port Royal's storied past. The bricks are recycled from the hundreds of thousands Marx reclaimed from the sunken city. Inside the hospital where naval officers once awaited treatment, artifacts await further study. A small selection reveals how life was lived in the pirate town at the time of the Great Quake. This was originally thought to be a cooking baster, but analysis of its contents at the British Museum revealed that it's really a urethra syringe. With it, a mixture of lime and molasses was injected into a man's penis to treat venereal disease. These lead pieces were used as weights in the fish and meat markets. Their markings, however, indicate an amount more than they actually weigh. Whoever patronized the salesman who used them got cheated. And a crushed pewter chamber pot permanently bears the impact of the earthquake's brutal force. But it's in the Institute of Jamaica, in Kingston, that one finds perhaps Marx's most valuable object.
Every diver dreams of finding a treasure chest, and here I actually found the wooden chest, and inside were 3,000 of the most perfect silver coins, because the same anaerobic conditions that protects all the organic material also protected the silver, and they were the most perfect coins I ever found.
This piece of eight, plundered by pirates from a Spanish galleon, is one of the few left from Marx's excavation. It's kept in a vault because most of the other coins have since disappeared and are presumed stolen, grim proof of their irresistible allure. It also provided the irrefutable proof the Jamaican government required to halt the planned dredging of the harbor. Because of Marx's work, the sunken city would not be disturbed, but rather discovered anew by future underwater explorers. Every underwater expedition to the sunken city at Port Royal has been distinctive. Edwin Link's 1959 exploration was the first and raised tantalizing possibilities for those who followed. The dig conducted by Bob Marx in the 1960s was the largest, yielding the greatest quantity of artifacts. In 1981, the longest and most detailed study of Port Royal began when the Jamaican government invited the Institute of Nautical Archaeology at Texas A&M to excavate. Donnie Hamilton led the expedition.
Originally, I said, okay, I will go 1 year and see what the conditions are like. So when we went out there, we found that we could conduct controlled excavations. We could take photographs. We could take underwater video. We could find artifacts. So what started to be a one-year trial excavation turned out to be 10 years of going to Jamaica. From that first year, we saw that there wasn't another site like it, probably in the world, that's comparable to what you find at Port Royal. Anybody who's interested in 17th century English archaeology, that's the site to excavate.
Unlike Bob Marx, whose site was predetermined by proposed harbor dredging, Hamilton could choose where he wanted to excavate. After consulting period maps of Port Royal, he selected what was once a busy intersection in the commercial center of town. This area was chosen because it's probably the only portion of the sunken city where one finds buildings that sank vertically with minimal distortion. This phenomenon was caused by the liquefaction that occurred during the earthquake. Hamilton's team uncovered eight buildings, ranging from a probable tavern and cobbler shop to private residences. Using a water dredge, a more flexible version of an airlift, Hamilton's team gathered artifacts at depths of less than 15 feet. It was just the first step of many to conserve the past.
Underwater archaeology is very expensive in terms of conservation. While we may spend 3 months working in the summer, it may take 3 to 5 years to conserve all the artifacts we bring up in one excavation season.
Hamilton explains the steps involved in the conservation of metal objects, the kind most susceptible to decay and incrustation.
The biggest problem we have with the artifacts from Port Royal is just the fact that they're all covered with marine growth and being 300 years in the salt water. And so the first process we have to go through is x-raying them to find out exactly what is inside each one of these incrustations or concretions. We take each encrusted object and make an x-ray of it before we start the conservation process, and then the x-ray shows the interior detail. On this x-ray, you can see the trigger of a gun. Here's the side plate of the gun, the spring inside behind the side plate, and then part of the hammer which held the gun flint. And the x-ray shows us clearly the degree of preservation, and it determines the next process as we go through. As soon as we evaluate the x-ray and determine what's inside, then we just start mechanically cleaning the incrustation off the object. Once we remove all the incrustation off an object, if there's any substantial metal remaining, we just put it into an electrolytic vat, and the electrical current as it flows through the object loosens up all the incrustation or the corrosion products, and it allows it just, you know, you flake it off with your finger. And this, in the process, it stabilizes the metal. Then after we go through electrolysis, we just go through a rinsing process to remove all the residue of this chemical, and then we seal the object off in a vat of microcrystalline wax, which then stabilizes it, and we're allowed to put it on display then.
This cross-section of artifacts collected by Hamilton and his underwater archaeologists illustrates the vibrant and varied life that flourished in Port Royal during the latter half of the 17th century. Onion-shaped liquor bottles and a clay pipe recall the laissez-faire attitude of the social scene. A cannonball and shot gauge confirm the strategic importance of the harbor. A porcelain Chinese foo dog offers exotic evidence of Port Royal's status as an international trading post. And a gold wedding ring, buckles, and a pearl earring hint at Port Royal's wealth. Ironically, they do not fit Hamilton's definition of treasure.
I'm an archaeologist, so I define treasure in terms of data. Data is a treasure because data is interpretable. You can do something with it. Gold to me is immaterial, but does it have marks on it that I can identify to a maker or to a time period? It directs our research, tells us where to go to find the historic documents or the records that fill in the gaps. And so that's what's a treasure to me.
To Hamilton, these seemingly ordinary pewter plates are treasure because they bear the mark of its maker, a pineapple with the initials SB. Searching for who SB was turns an archaeologist into a detective and demonstrates the invaluable role documents play in reconstructing the past. After consulting several archives, including a 1680 Port Royal census, Hamilton discovered that SB was Simon Benning, a local pewter maker. Further research located his will, providing information on his family and property holdings, while his inventory quantified his success as a pewter maker.
We know from Simon Benning's inventory that he had over 2,000 finished plates, which is a very large inventory. Essentially, he's the only pewter maker in the entire island.
With only a set of initials as his starting point, Hamilton's research ended with a profile of Simon Benning, Port Royal's pewter maker. He was likely born in Tuthill, England, came to Port Royal via Barbados around 1663, bought property on High Street, had a wife, two sons, and a daughter, prospered in his trade, and died in 1687, 5 years before the Great Quake.
I like Simon Benning because essentially I brought him back to life through the excavation and the research that we conducted with the artifacts that we could relate back to him.
Bringing back to life the citizens of Port Royal doesn't always require an artifact with a mark on it or documentation. Sometimes the past becomes more human simply by an act of compassion. While excavating the last structure on their site, Hamilton and his team found the remains of three children caught in the quake. It was enough to stir the heart of even the most professionally detached archaeologist.
One child was at the back hearth, and the wall fell over, and so the child was between the wall and the floor. And then we found another child at the front door at the house. Either the child was either running into the house or running out of the house, but it was right at the front door.
Yeah, this is the cutting edge. You're listening to Port Royal. Maybe I've never heard it like that before, but it's just the history of Port Royal and the archaeological findings that people come and excavate and found in Port Royal as them land it the wickedest city on earth in that time. Earthquake shake it. Scientists them tell you why it gets shake. The Christian them say it's because it is the wickedest place. We don't know what going on with Montego Bay then. Given what is happening there. This is the cutting edge.
So in a situation like that, you know, there is an emotional involvement.
Hamilton had the children's remains buried in the graveyard of St. Peter's Church. Their modest tablet may not lure any treasure seekers, but it's valuable in its own right. It's the only memorial to the victims of the earthquake of 1692. In spite of the impressive recoveries made by the Link, Marks, and Hamilton expeditions, much of Port Royal has yet to be explored. Of the 33 acres that originally sank, 20 have been lost to reconsolidation, nature's own landfill process. Of the remaining 13 sunken acres, only 3.5 have been excavated.
Only a very small area of Port Royal has been excavated because it is such a time-consuming thing to work underwater, and because you're working in 10-centimeter levels as you dig, it takes a long time to excavate a single area.
Marianne Franklin, a PhD candidate at the Institute of Nautical Archaeology, is planning the next excavation at Port Royal. Her site is the shipwreck of what is believed to be the Ranger, a vessel with a curious history. Of French origin, it was seized off the west coast of Africa by Bartholomew Roberts, also known as Black Bart, one of history's most infamous pirates.
He was interesting because, unlike most pirates, he was a teetotaler, and he made his men sign articles. Every pirate had to sign articles agreeing to the rules of the ship, and his included no swearing and no drinking and lights out by 8 o'clock.
On the high seas, however, Black Bart was a terror, raiding and plundering at will during the early 18th century. The British Navy finally brought him down after a long pursuit and a short battle off the Guinea coast. Following Robert's bloody death, the Ranger returned to Port Royal, where it sank in a hurricane in 1722. Bob Marks located a shipwreck during his excavations in the 1960s that loosely fit the description of the vessel. Franklin intends to determine definitively if it is the Ranger. She doesn't expect to find pirate plunder on board during this exploratory dive. Anything of monetary value has long since been salvaged. But Franklin does hope to find her own version of treasure.
Treasure for an archaeologist is not material goods, things you can hold or sell for monetary value. What's neat is that you can go down, look at the archaeological record, put it with the historical record, and get a better understanding of a different time in the past, then make sure that the information you find gets to the public so that kids can understand, because if you just keep what you find to yourself, you're no better than the pirates. The interesting thing about finding the Ranger and doing this excavation now is, as we speak, they're excavating Blackbeard's vessel, Queen Anne's Revenge, off the coast of Carolina. These two vessels were both used by the pirates at the end of the Golden Age of Piracy in 1721. So archaeologically, we'll have something to compare it to from the same era, another vessel. And these are the only two ships that have been excavated by archaeologists using controlled techniques.
But Bob Marks proves, however, that one need not utilize the controlled techniques of an archaeologist to recover a wealth of artifacts in the waters off Port Royal. He shows just how easy it is during his first return to the sunken city in over 30 years.
I went out there in 40 minutes just using snorkel equipment because no scuba equipment was available, and hand fanning with my little hand, I went and found all these little goodies you see here, and it gives you an idea of the diversity of different stuff there.
Among Marx's finds are broken bits of Chinese porcelain, musket balls, a child's marble, broken pipe stems. These two, when put together, reveal where the pipe was made, Glasgow, Scotland.
Yeah, you're listening to Port Royal. Port Royal. I know a lot of you have never heard it like that before, but as we said, this is school. This is sometimes church, tabernacle, mosque. This is a history of Port Royal. Something that you might have heard in school, but not like this before. Cutting Edge. We're there with you. It's now 7 minutes past 12. As we tell you before, this next part of the program is dedicated to this day, the 2nd of November. On the 2nd of November, 1930, a man by the name of Tafari Makonnen was crowned Emperor of Ethiopia. Haile Selassie I. So, as Rastafari, we celebrate. And this program, we celebrate it musically. We're going to celebrate it musically. We're going to play some ads and come back to it. Cutting Edge. Celebrate Emperor Haile Selassie I's coronation day with music. Here goes.
And I looked up, there was a man coming towards me, which I found very striking. He was immaculately dressed, but he was... And I looked up, there was a man coming towards me, which I found very striking. He was immaculately dressed, but he was quite small, but very, very powerful. Great sense of energy coming off him. And he walked up to us and spoke to us. And with great charm, he had a very gentle, quiet voice, very quiet. He patted me on the head, and I can remember to this day the sense of being in the presence of someone who was more than a man. His eyes were very powerful, very dark, but very truthful.
Yeah, today is the 2nd of November, celebrating Emperor Haile Selassie coronation day, which happened on the 2nd of November, 1930, Ethiopia. Yeah, then at the center celebration here. Musical celebration commemorating the coronation of Emperor Haile Selassie I on the 2nd of November, 1930, in Ethiopia. You know, Rastafari, all over the world, right now, from Ethiopia to Jamaica, from America to Africa. See this day as one of the most auspicious days in the Rastafari calendar. So we continue the journey musically, you understand, because there's so much music that praise Emperor Haile Selassie I and Rastafari that we could have stayed until tomorrow and still play more and more and more and more. We continue the journey. Here goes.
It is good that you are here to record this picture of me in my palace garden at Addis Ababa. People who see this throughout the world will realize that even in the 20th century, with faith, courage, and a just cause, David will still beat Goliath.
Those of you who don't know this song, this is the original voice of Emperor Haile Selassie I. With the speech that Bob Marley did over and called it war. We was told for a lot about this tune many, many times. This is like an anthem, you know. Yeah, this is like an anthem. We want to remind the people that today I will do a little more from this, from 2 to 5:45 with the Stepping Razor. We have a special half hour tomorrow between 5 and, well, not more than 5 and 5:45. We are going to present the, well, according to the Stepping Razor. This is not a scientific poll, no scientific thing, but we're going to present the top 5 reggae album for 2017. You don't want to miss that. The top 5 reggae album for 2017 according to the Stepping Razor. And we're going to present the number 1 single for 2017 according to the Stepping Razor. So we don't want to miss that. Very, very calculating effort. Understand, and we know a lot of people have whole heap of different in their mind, but we choose 5. Well, it's 10 we choose, you know, but we're gonna play 5 of them. We might tell you the whole 10, but it's 5 of them we're going to play. The 5 top reggae albums for 2017, according to the Stepping Razor, and also the number one single, according to the Stepping Razor. So here we go again. You know, say, we couldn't depend on the radio and days like this, and we don't really give our input. This time we decide not to talk enough, but to give praises through the music. Because, you know, over the years, we use the secular music to project a spiritual understanding and a spiritual knowing. I don't have no pop music like Jamaican music where project spirituality. We continue the journey. Yes, we continue the journey. You know, so we are playing the wrong tune, though. We are playing the wrong version of that tune, you know. Believe you me. We are playing the wrong version of that tune, so me and I will look for the right version. We are going to get this. Just hope that you enjoy the offering that we provide. As we say, we're celebrating Emperor Haile Selassie's coronation. The 2nd of November 1930. Today is the 2nd of November 2017. So you check that. We want you to know that we will be here again from 2 to 5:45. And at 5, well after the cash party, you'll be presenting the top 5 reggae album for 2017 according to the Stepping Razor, and the number 1 single according to the Stepping Razor. So we don't want you to miss that. And you know, so we have some explosive things that we want to explore. We want to give thanks to Fluffy Diva outside. Fluffy Diva outside, my boy. Give thanks to Fluffy Diva. I don't know where we are going, but Sanjay left here from early. But we are continuing the journey. Yes, continue the journey. I think at 12, I'm alone. Them tell you I must leave here at 12 o'clock. When the program done 2 o'clock. But I don't know nothing. I will survive. I have been surviving for 20 years. So here we are. Who are you, Vita? First, you see Vita come along at the studio at the night, you know. Who are you, Vita? Say, he might bring extra food. Who are you, look? Iwawa? We say, Iwawa, don't you at dinner at the night, yeah? Who are you, him up? Yes, who are you, him up? My brethren. Yeah, man. My brethren. So, we give thanks, as we say. I hope you like the music. A Rastafari vibes we are dealing with. You understand? Yes. Rastafari vibe. If we not do it, we don't know what we do it. So, clock a play trick for me, you know. Where are the matrix? Oh, what kind of clock that, Rasta? No, I tell you, say, it get me bummy a while ago, you know, after me don't run. Hey, you see, that place have a mad people, you know, Rasta. No, I tell you, that place have a mad, you know. Because after me, I look for the clock and I say, at 2 o'clock, I'm going to see you come in. I'm look back for the clock and I say, 1 o'clock. A crack, you know. Crack, man. Crack. A crack, Rasta. Crack. It's like them. It's like a daylight saving time, you know. How it go? Eh? No, you sure say, you know, no, but if it's not going change, it's not change at 12, right? I then would I tell you, wait, let me look for me thing I have time change, Rasta, because at 2 o'clock, Rasta, 2 minutes past 2, my clock say. That's a 2 minutes past 1. At 2 minutes past 2. No, I'm frightened, you know. Come here, so I'm going to close up the program at 1 o'clock. You know, anyway, give thanks to the moment. Give thanks to the time. We're there with you again. So you know, man? You're good. You are scared of people in your community with the bulb. Hey, you can't imagine you as a red man and put the bulb in your mouth and I light it up. No, if all me who know how the bulb work would have run for you, you know. No red man is supposed to put the ball glad about and light it up, you know. You can't just imagine the nigga there with them to that. Yes, anyway. And you know, so tomorrow we have a little special feature upon the Stepping Razor. The top five reggae album for 2017. Him now listen to me, you know. But you can't use your phone, Bertrand. At 2 years, you have, you know. I don't know why, man. Just like when you have two eyes. When you look two eyes, one thing you see, you know. I just wait for a time. I say, I have a special feature tomorrow upon the Stepping Razor. The top five reggae albums for 2017. It is not a scientific poll, but I use in my judgment according to where we play over the period of the year. Yeah, last week we mentioned it. And I'm going to present the top single. Reggae, me a deal with it, you know. Come here to dance hall. I don't know where it is at the dance hall. Like, yeah. It's a presumptuous of me to go say, me a present. Unless me go gather up the whole town.
But dance hall was really the surrounding.
Yeah, me not talk about history of the thing, man. Oh, you can't care history of the thing. You know what? Do your program.
No, I'm sure
you said. No, because if you go history, no, me sit down here, so I make you go and tell me the history, you know. Yeah, what may I say? I would be presumptuous to say I'm going to present the top five dancehall album unless I consult Uno.
Yeah, yeah.
But I can't but I consult Uno. Too much problem. Yeah, too much problem. I don't go tell me some truth when I don't want to play for my program.
Why? We have to go search for some real good album. That's well,
all the dancehall man, if you say every dancehall album, wicked. Yeah, everyone I want to feel said the dancehall has been and the top dancehall single. You know, say man that come shoot me for that.
Yeah.
Anyone will shoot man shoot you know, cause you should have deal with the other one. Mm-hmm. If you go to popcorn a man shoot you and say you should have said my boy if I shoot. You understand? You know but shot would I get. So we are playing safe. When we say reggae now. We know the reggae man them now come shoot me. Yeah, they were gonna say. Sure, we move to a deal. Not the number one, but them cool. Them not going to do that. You can't imagine me going to say, the number one tune is El Chapo by Popcorn. You guy, hey, I'm going to buy it. I'm going to deal it. I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to deal it. You understand? I'm mad at my man. Yeah, when my father did a bigger tune than that, and then Ding Dong come with fame, things like that. You understand? So, me know when I say reggae, I'm safe. I'm not definitely not the dancer. You know what I'm saying? I'm not definitely not the dancer thing, you know. No, I'm not definitely not at all. Anyway, we're gone, you know. Later, you understand? Later, we'll be greater. Here we go. Last tune, and it was carried out, yes.